Hello, it's Kevin Bacon again. You can see the fog on the lens. It is so hot out here. We've had so much rain in the last couple of weeks. 7-8 inches probably, maybe more. And threatens every day. Coming up here to the shop, thought I would show you how I get into this. We'll hope that the lens clears off. Because the camera was inside where it's cool and out here it's quite warm. Now, I have an advantage here. That have trees all around the shop here. Can't see a thing, can you? And the trees are blocking the sun, so I get some shade. There's a nice breeze here, and we're gonna open up the semi-trailer. Okay, I wipe the lens a little bit. What I do is I open up that lock right there and throw this thing open. Okay, now you can see. We remove this high security lock, throw open the doors, then we go over here to the side, turn on a battery charger, and down comes the workbench. So that's it. See, I don't do anything by hand. There's a vise right here on the side that comes down with it. It's a small vise, but it gives me a lot of place to work, and I can hook my ground clamps right to that and clamp things in the vise and weld right there. So that's going to get our project started. Man, steamy and humid. Got my little fan going back here to keep me a little bit cooler. Helps a little bit, but it's pretty bad. This is a piece of angle iron, obviously heavy angle iron, 3/8 thick, 4-inch on side. So monster angle iron. This is the basis for the project that I'm going to make today. I have an angle bracket that I got from the Habitat for Humanity store. And I have a stack of door hinges. Now, none of this needs to make any sense right away, but the project that I'm working on is I want to make a copy machine. Actually, not really a copy machine, but I want to be able to transfer points from a pattern to a project relatively precisely, so I can stick it on the lathe and then turn down to the depth of those pre-marked, pre-drilled, if you will, holes. And what I'm going to do is build a pantograph, sort of. The idea is that this can move up and down, but it won't move left and right, and it won't vary this way. So that the stylus that's doing the reading is over here, goes up and down. The router on the other side also goes up and down. And we can move the workpiece underneath this. Now, what I've looked at on regular pantographs tells me that there's a lot of room for things to be not quite angularly perfect with that. And I want this to be quite precise. So we have a nice solid edge to work with here, up against here to slide the wood up against. I'll think about it in a minute. You know, you've got one on your table saw. You run the wood past it. And then, as we want to move forward or backward on the project, in or out, we can place other things up against this to spacer it out evenly, push it underneath, and we'll just call it a guide for right now. Anyway, there we are. That's the idea. I've had this piece of steel hanging around here for, wow, probably 20 years. It had another chunk on it. I took it up into the old bandsaw and cut it off. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to take these hinges and weld them on here, and then place another hinge above that hinge like so and weld it on here. And then these will be able to float up and down with each other, because there's going to be a bar here and a bar here, and those bars will be connected the same way out here, and that will keep the router going parallel up and down evenly. And there will be a minimum amount of wobbling. Now, these hinges are quite tall, so the two hinges that mount on here may have to be shortened up before I'm done. So I've got to do some calculations and some figuring. As soon as I get all that stuff figured out, we'll get started. I'm using this piece of 3/4-inch weldable steel tube for my arms. They don't have to be very long. I don't want this to be a great big long thing. It's already going to be plenty heavy with this. So it's important that I don't add too much more weight to it, because I've got to carry it from here down into the wood shop in the basement when I'm done. All right, I'm going to do some laying out and get things ready to go here. I will cut this on the bandsaw inside there. You say, well, how do you get in there? Well, it's real simple. I let this wheelchair lift down. I get on it. I use it for a step, or else I run it up and lift myself into the shop. It's the handiest thing I've ever put on here. Amazingly, amazingly handy. All right. I'll get at her. I'll get back when I have some marks that make sense. Okay. It's a fence. It's a fence. So that's, I remembered the word. You know, these old brains get brain bubbles in them sometimes, but this will act as a fence. I can tell you it's rained so much here right now that the stand that I made for my anvil is sinking into the ground over here, and there's some question as to whether it'll want to tip over or not. A bunch of my hinges have these little locating, we'll call them dowels, sticking up here. And what I'm going to do, you just bash those things down. At least that's the plan. So that they don't stick up. Because right now they're in the way. I bought a bunch of hinges. I got them. That's kind of funny. They're all identical. Basically. Size hinges. Made the same place. Everything. The difference is that some of them were 25 cents a piece, and some of them were 50 cents a piece. So, you know, it just depended on, I guess, who was marking them that particular day, or what day they got marked, or whatever. And that does vary things at secondhand stores. You have to be careful and sort through. Know that one of these other ones is gonna dimple on it too, and we'll get it before we're done. Anyway, that gives you. Then I'm gonna take these two hinges and lay them together so they fold together like that, and I'm gonna weld the hinge itself right here on the corner, and on the other corner I'm gonna tack it. Then I'll open them up and secure them together so that I need four pairs. I need two pairs for out here, and I need two pairs for over here. Ah, here's the other one. There we go. So now we have a flat hinge. So we need two pairs for each side, one here, a pair out here, and a pair out here. So I'll get to working on that, and we'll get back. I know somebody always wants to know what kind of equipment you're using. So this is a Northern Industrial Tools MIG 135. It's a pretty good little welder. I've got a Clark up in here. I've got a Century. I've got a Harbor Freight. So I have three other. I use flux core wire. I don't have time to mess with gas. So that's there. If we need to get hotter, then I've got a Stickmate Hobart over here. Hobart Stickmate LX, and it's both AC-DC. It's a great little machine. I really, really like it. If it gets too hot out here, there's also an air conditioner sitting back there that I could swing around here and cool myself off. Well, we have just about everything in here. It's in a horrible mess because of the conditions of some projects, but we will get there. We will get there. Okay, I have set up a set of hinges here in the vise. Oh, yeah, I knocked my finger up on some glass yesterday. I want them pressed together tightly. They need to be pretty close. Now, we're not talking about precision here. What I'm looking at is more repeatability. If the whole thing is just a little bit off and I make the adjustments, it'll be work. And of course, we're working with door hinges here, for heaven's sakes. So we're not going to get thousandths of an inch precision. There's no use getting too ridiculous on a lot of these projects, trying to be too absolutely perfect, because your end result's not going to be any better. It doesn't matter what you do. So I'm going to put a tiny little weld right here. Then I'm going to flip this over and put a tiny little weld on the other side, set it over there and let it cool, and go to the next one. I have all four sets here. Okay, my helmet. Yeah, this is it right here. I shipped Amazon.com. I got this thing. Oh, I love it. It's got all the fancy controls on the inside. Auto darkening. You may be able to see me through it. I don't know. That would be a shame, wouldn't it? Anyway, auto darkening. Then on the outside here, I can turn it off so that I can grind without the thing getting dark, and then I can open it up. And I, most of the time when I'm welding with this wire welder, I'm welding on the lightest setting on this hood, because the wire welder just isn't that bright. And yes, I'm wearing short pants. It's hot out here. And yes, I'm wearing knockoff clogs. So once in a while, a little spark gets in on my foot. But for me, it's just too hot out here to put a whole bunch of other stuff on. I suggest you deal with your safety the best you can, and don't necessarily take your cue from me. Okay, the helmet goes on. I'm not going to do this on camera, just simply because I don't know if this camera will take that brightness, and I don't want to ruin my expensive camera. All right, we got four sets of hinges here. One thing you're going to notice, that since the hinges are opposite each other, there's one direction that this won't work, because they both have to flip over and go this direction in order for this to work. And these two move up and down together. So you want to make sure that your hinges, when you put them on your finished product, that there's not a spot there that's going to get you in trouble like that. See, that would get you in trouble. That would go up, but it won't go down any more than that. So we put that on top in the back, because we don't care. It can go up quite a ways, but it can only go down that far. If it goes down that far, it's already hitting the table. So if it's already hitting the table, that's far enough down. So we set up our hinges to match each other like that, because I'm dyslexic and I'm going to do it backwards. And these out here will probably have to be in reverse. So my suggestion is, make a little tack and try it. And if it doesn't work, you can knock it apart. Now, I got to tell you that when I was welding these welds, there were a couple times that a little piece jumped over like that. It is amazing how strong that tiny little tack is when you go to pop this apart. Here's one over here. See how close we can get to that. See that tiny little tack? I drove this big screwdriver down through the other side until it popped apart, and it took a fair amount of effort. Is it enough to trust your life? No, but it's enough to give you fits if you're not careful when you're assembling something. So now I'm going to get my measurements over here, and we'll get started laying out the actual, I don't know, we call it a pantograph. All right, there we are. I got the hinges laid out on there. I'm going to weld them down now. I placed them where I did basically by guess and by golly. I want the most bang for my buck here. They're about 4 inches from the end of this 30 inch, which gives me a fair amount in the middle, allows me to work with some fairly good sized projects under here without perhaps getting too waggly. Excuse me. So all I did was lay the hinge up here to the top, flat across the top, and I'm going to weld that down, and it laid the hinge over there. And as you can see, this piece is stopped by its own hinge, but we wanted to make sure that was on top because that will easily be hitting the table when it's down. And when we do the other end, and you'll see as we go along, it will also have to be set up so that when it's down, it's hitting the hinge and so that it has the freedom to travel upward quite a ways. All right, I'm going to weld these down and we'll stand it up. All right, we have most of the pieces now cut to put this thing together. What I'm going to do now is begin to assemble it. And as I assemble it, maybe you can get a better picture of what we're dealing with as we go along. This piece of angle iron here on the top forces these two hinges to work together. And I'm going to weld two pieces of square tubing, one to each end. They will be our upper levers. All of this is just tacked right now. I'll finish weld it in a minute. Now we have two arms traveling up together at the same rate. On the other end of the two arms then go two more hinges that are going to be hooked together by another piece of this angle iron. So I'm going to set all that up, weld that up, stick it together, and we'll take a look. Okay, piece of angle welded between the outer hinges across here. Once again, just a tack. Now we have the bottom arms welded to the bottom hinges, like so. And this whole mechanism turns around here, shoves up in here, and gets attached to this other set of hinges. Okay, so I'm going to do that. Now, the final thing to do here will be to weld these top rails to these other hinges. Before I do that, I'm going to finish the welds on the rest of the assembly so that I can get inside places that I won't be able to get after this thing is all put together. If that felt like a really long time, it really was a really long time. I went in the house and cooled off because it's oppressively hot out here. Anyway, there it is, it's welded up. Now, it's a little stiff right now, but as you can see, this goes up and down evenly all the way across. I think I've still got, pretty well done with the welding. I'm gonna turn it sideways now. So you can see what we're trying to accomplish here is that this plate remains straight up and down, regardless of the position of the height. Now, then we take this tool and mount it on this end, or the other end, it doesn't really matter. And what we'll end up with is a copy pantogram, kind of on its side, where the item goes underneath a pin over here. Ouch, that's still hot. Yeah, didn't take me very long to check it. And then the cutter will go up and down with that. Now all it's going to take for me to loosen these hinges up is just rap on them a little bit with a hammer and they'll all come loose. But right now we're just going to leave it stiff. I don't mind that a bit. This part back here will probably clamp down anyway. And there you go. So now the next trick will be to figure out how to secure this on here. This is a actual real honest to goodness roto zip tool. I got it $15. $15 at a pawn shop. So it works fine. Only thing I could tell is that somebody lost the little deal out of here that locks the armature so that you can take the bit out. No big deal to me. I don't care. So there we are. And now I've got to let this thing all cool down so I can carry it in the house and mount it down and get some other things done to it. And we'll be ready to try this thing out. We'll call this one a video. Ken Bacon. Bye for now.